My guest today is a return guest, Mary Kreitz, who is the trauma specialist with CNA. So it's been a while since you've been on the show. So refresh our viewers about what you do at CNA and about yourself.
Okay. Well, I do a few different things at CNA. The main thing is that I am a counselor. I work with clients. I specialize in trauma. So I do work with kids that have been through some really awful things in mm-hmm. their lives and try to help them get through it. And the other thing that I do is that I'm the training director for the agency. So I do a lot of our in-house trainings. I do some trainings out in the community, and I try to coordinate to bring in trainers for our staff to make sure that we're staying on top
up
of
to date.
Yeah, the latest developments in the field, and just making sure that everybody gets the information they need to do their jobs well.
Okay. All right. Well, recently you did an event with college students, which is a little out of your normal.
Yes.
When you really work with teenagers in high school. And so you did a QPR gatekeeper training, and then you also led a suicide prevention panel. So tell us about those events.
Yeah. QPR gatekeeper is a suicide recognition and prevention program. QPR stands for Question, Persuade, Refer. And really, it's useful for everyone mm-hmm. to be able to recognize the signs that a person might be in distress and might actually be at risk for suicide. And then to know, like, how do you respond to that? Because the truth is, most people, when they're in that kind of a crisis, they're gonna talk to their friends, their mm-hmm. family members. They're gonna talk to someone they know casually rather than walk in to an agency and say, I need to talk to a counselor. So I do these trainings to basically help people to feel comfortable if they are concerned that this is my friend
right.
and they might be suicidal. Now what do I say?
So what's the next thing I say to them?
So helping them to be comfortable to ask that question, are you thinking about suicide? Helping to persuade them that life is worth living. At least, can you make it through today? Can you live until tomorrow? Mm-hmm. And then refer to get them to some professional help. Help to connect them with someone that can help out more long term. But a lot of times that
first step is mm-hmm. so important.
That first critical moment can make a huge difference. So we did the training with some college students to make sure that they're aware of this information and prepared if it should ever come up mm-hmm. in their life, that they know what to do. Mm-hmm. And then we had the panel where we had some amazing panelists who shared their personal insights, their personal experiences, which is a very brave thing to do. And they were phenomenal in just, again, sharing some of the stressors that might lead up to a person becoming suicidal, and then sharing some of those things we can do to support mm-hmm. the young people so that they can get through difficult times without wanting to end their life.
So do you think you'll do that again in the future with college students?
I would love to do uh-huh. that again in the future with college students. I enjoy the variety because I get uh-huh. to work with really young kids. I get to work with some teenagers. And then this was a great chance to, you know, bring that up to the college level, because it's all a big continuum. It's not like behavioral health problems stop when you graduate from high school.
Of course not.
It continues on. So it's kind of neat to see that different perspective. And the panelists came from a lot of different perspectives. We had some traditional students who came straight from high school. We mm-hmm. also had another woman who was a little bit older and had worked for a while before going to college. And so a lot of differences in the way they see the world and the types of things they're dealing with in their lives. Really neat.
Okay. Well, speaking of spreading out over an area, you work at CNA, but you also, when there's a trauma in the county, have been called out to help with dealing with that. So tell us a little bit about those situations.
Okay. So there's a couple of different ways that this comes up. There is a countywide team called the CISM team. That's Crisis Intervention Stress Management. And we are from a lot of different agencies mm-hmm. and backgrounds in the community, but basically when there is a crisis situation, people can call and request this team or members of it mm-hmm. to come out and provide some immediate care for the people, that are affected by this. And depending on the situation, we might do a lot of different things. We might help to coordinate information. We might sit down with people and talk to them mm-hmm. and help them get through it. We do a lot of helping people to just mobilize their resources and their coping skills so that they can get through rough times. Because the truth is that in a crisis situation, most people don't actually need counseling. Most people are not going to end up with PTSD. They're going to need some self-care. Mm-hmm. They're going to need to talk to their friends, their resources. They're going to need to do some extra work to get through it because it's a really tough situation. But there's only a few people that are really going to be affected to a clinical level where right. they need ongoing counseling.
Okay. All right. When a trauma situation happens to a child or family, what are some basic information that you give them to deal with it?
There's three basic needs that all people have. And so I try to use that as sort of the center to ground. What can you do? Everybody needs to feel safe. So what can we do to reassure this kid that they're safe? Mm-hmm. And depending on how old they are, you might do that in different ways. With really little kids, a lot of times it's saying things like, Mom and Dad are here for you. They're going to take care of you. We're going to handle this. Mm-hmm. You're going to be okay. When kids are older, that's not enough. You need to explain a little bit more to them. But again, we can reassure them, well, what are we doing to handle it? What are we doing to help keep you safe? What can you do to keep yourself safe in the future? People need to feel connected. And so sometimes it's just as simple as having someone with you. Mm-hmm. Because going through a difficult time by yourself is terrifying.
Right.
So having someone that cares, that sees your pain uh-huh. and says, I'm here for you. It's better when that's someone you have a relationship with, but sometimes it's okay if it's just a caring stranger who says, hey, I'm here for you today. Talk to me about what's going on. And basic things, making sure they got something to eat, making sure they're drinking something. Crises are dehydrating. we're constantly needing to replenish ourselves. Just reminding people to do things like sleep, relax, take a breath. All of those things can be really helpful. And people need to feel in control. That's the third need that we have. And sometimes that is as simple as knowing what's going to happen next. Sometimes it's finding out the details of what did happen. Mm-hmm. A lot of times rumors go around or information goes around and you go, wait, this person said this and someone else said this. Which one is really it?
The right.
So yeah. Finding out the accurate information, finding out what is available for them, because sometimes people need information like where can I go? Who can I talk to? What can I do next? So getting that information and really giving it to them, because also people's brains are not performing at their best in a crisis. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's things like spelling things out that normally you would know this, mm-hmm. but right now your brain isn't coming up with it. So I'm going to remind you, okay, here's some things that you're going to need to take care of, or what plans have you made to handle these things? And so really just getting them through that moment. And then always you're keeping your eyes out to triage for those people that need more help
okay.
and then connecting them to that kind of help.
So specifically, if you're called to a school for a traumatic thing, what is the first thing that you do with the administrators or the staff?
One of the first things that you do is you identify a list of who are the most affected people.
Okay.
So there's a lot of different situations where we might be called out, mm-hmm. but common ones include someone has been in an accident, mm-hmm. Or someone has died, whether that is for any different reason or whether it's a student or a faculty member. Still, you want to find out who are the people most affected, who were the close friends, who were the people that were in class
in the area, yeah.
with this person, who are the teachers, or was there anyone they had conflict with recently? You also want to look at people who have been struggling a lot, because sometimes it's not the person who knew them that is struggling the most. It's someone who says, oh, that could have been me.
Yeah.
Or it's someone who says, wow, they had it together way more than I did.
What's going to happen to me?
What's going to happen to me?
Yeah.
So, you know, identifying those people and just checking in with them, making sure that they're okay, making sure that they know people care. A lot of times it is coordinating. Are there enough people to take care of the staff? Schools are amazing because they have counselors on site, but those counselors often knew that person too. It was their coworker or their student. And so making sure that while they're taking care of everybody else, that someone is taking care of them. Uh-huh. So sometimes it's useful to do that, because in a crisis, knowing that you're being useful and you're being helpful actually is a coping skill.
Yeah.
But then making sure afterward that someone checks in to say, you've been super busy today. How are you coping? How yeah. are you doing with this?
And you've mentioned self-care several times, and you deal with trauma on a daily basis and horrible things. So what do you personally do for self-care?
One of the things I do is that every night before I go to bed, I make a list for myself of at least three good things.
Okay.
Something I saw that day that was beautiful. Mm-hmm. Something that I saw, like an interaction that was really great. Something that I'm just grateful for mm-hmm. in my life.
And a lot of people call that a gratitude journal,
yes.
you know, or
yeah.
whatever, the three things.
Some days I'll fill pages because I've got a lot, and some days
so it's a struggle.
Some days it is a struggle, and there have been days that I'm like indoor plumbing. I'm really grateful for indoor plumbing. Some days you got to dig deep to find them, but you know, I am very lucky that I have an amazing family. I have great friends. So I do make time to make sure that I'm spending time with them. I make time to do the things that bring joy to my life. I love to read. I love to, you know, go take a walk, and we have amazing parks around here. Uh-huh. So I love to go walk through a park. Making sure that you have time to do that, because it's very easy to be like, oh no, I've got all these things I need to do.
Uh-huh.
And push that off to the side.
I'll get to it later myself. Yeah,
you never get to it later. If you make it a priority and schedule it, just as important as all the other appointments that I've got to do today, I'm going to go take my walk,
mm-hmm.
or I'm going to sit down and read my book for an hour. That helps. That mm-hmm. makes a big difference in keeping your own sanity and your own emotional stability. So I make a point to do that regularly.
Great advice, great advice. Well, anything else that you wanted to add before we close the program?
I think that, you know, a lot of people are struggling, mm-hmm. and I think that it's just really important that we're there for each other and checking in with each other, whether we're professionals or just friends.
Friends, yeah.
It's really just so important to let people know, I see you and I care.
Okay, all right. Well, thanks, Mary, for being with us again
today.
Thank
you so much.
And thank you for watching Q&A with CNA. I'm Kyle Schwarz.